How's that? Can everybody hear me all right?
Yeah.
So once again, good morning, all.
Good morning.
So glad to see all of you have gathered together to worship with us today. This is our communion Sunday, and so we hope that you've already prepared your minds and hearts to receive the emblems of the broken body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. I really think that where we're headed in this series in Isaiah 53, it really ties in with communion, and it really, hopefully, if I do it right, it'll all tie in to the Easter season of what the cross and the resurrection, what it's really all about. So I think it's most appropriate that we are in Isaiah 53. Just several more things before we read and pray today. Certain folks we want to constantly keep in prayer. Sister Juanita, Sister Caitlin had a minor procedure. Pastor Smith said he hurt his leg somehow. Can't already put any weight on it. I told him I think it's age, amen. I hurt my ankle, and to this day I can't tell you how I did it. But it's healing, but just slowly. So pray for those folks going through those things. If you haven't heard, Sister Lenora is really, really sick. And she's in really, really, she's in bad shape. So let us constantly lift her up in much prayer. Amen?
Amen.
When I got the call last night, I had a hard time sleeping all night just thinking about her. This is a beautiful sister in the Lord. She suffered with asthma and whatnot for a lot of years. I've never heard her complain. Even when she has not been feeling the best, whatever you ask her, she'll do it. And just a beautiful sister in the Lord. And we really, really want to lift her up in prayer. She had a very bad asthma attack. It was so bad, they flew her by helicopter, if I'm hearing this correctly, to University Hospital. Amen?
Amen.
So they could better treat her. So let's really, really pray for Sister Lenore, her husband, Brother Schmitty, Starla, Bryson, Debbie, all of those. It is extremely difficult when a loved one gets sick and it just comes on like that. It's acute and you don't know where it's going to go. It is overwhelming. And when I thought about Sister Lenora, I couldn't help but think about my mother when she had a stroke. All I can tell you is I hope you never have to go through that. It's a very, very difficult, earth-shattering time. So I get it. I understand it. And so I understand that the family needs much prayer. Sister Lenora needs much prayer. And we need to uphold them and help them all that we can. Pray that the Lord will deliver her. We don't know why God permits these things. But we do know, in spite of how we see it, God is always in control. Nothing has slipped up on God.
Amen.
God has a plan. God has a purpose. We don't all understand that. But in the midst of all of that, God still says for us to let our requests be made known unto him. Amen.
Amen.
And so our request is that God would heal her and raise her and bring her back sound in body to us and to her family, most importantly. And so let's pray for that. Continue to pray for Sister Juanita, ongoing battles with cancer. And it's a lot for us.
Yes.
I mean, we're a small church. We depend upon one another. It's not like a larger church. A lot of people come to church. You don't know who they are. And you just pass it in the night. We're a small church. We're a family church. And so these things, they really hurt us. At least it does me. Amen?
Amen.
And we all feel that and sense that. And it should move us to much prayer and support. As an old preacher said, because our day is coming. Nobody leaves this world unscathed. Amen?
Amen.
So it also lets us know, you know, we need to serve the Lord with all of our might while we can. Because you may get to a point you can't do it anymore. But the problem is, if you've never done nothing really for the Lord up to that point, and then you get to the point where you can't, that's what you're going to have to give to the Lord when you face Him. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says we're all going to give an account, and we don't take that seriously of what we've done as Christians to determine remorse and losses. That's what I keep saying. You know, I don't know if I'm really, you know. I know we say, even so, Lord, come, but I get to thinking about me, amen. Wait a little while longer, amen, so I can build a little more. So these things are critical, amen?
Yes, amen.
This is why we really need to give the Lord our best.
Yes.
While we can, amen?
Amen.
So let us all stand today. We have a beautiful time of fellowship. Last Sunday evening with Heritage Reform Baptist Church in Pastor Walker Creek. And they're sort of like us. They hung around for a long time. Amen. And we ate and fellowship and got to intermingle. So it was a beautiful time in the Lord. I think someone said we got 127 in here or something like that.
Yeah.
127. But I think only about 15 of them were from our congregation. So, yeah, I'm picking on you a little bit. Amen. So we had 127, about 15 from our church. And so, we need to step it up. Amen.
Amen.
You need to step it up. That's all I'm going to say. I think y'all deserve a little chime on that one. Amen. Am I wrong, Mr. Cole? All right. So that's all I'm going to say on that. Let's stand as we come to worship the Lord today. Psalm 37 through 40. Let's read.
I have seen the wicked by the man spreading himself like a luxurious tree in its native soil. Then he passed away, and lo, he was no more. I sought for him, but he could not be found. Mark the blameless man, and will live upright. For the man of peace will have prosperity, but transgressors will be altogether destroyed. The posterity of the wicked will be cut off, but the salvation of the righteous is from the Lord. He is their strength in time of trouble. The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and saves them, because they take refuge in Him.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we praise You and thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ. Those of us who are redeemed, Lord, we thank You. We know that it was nothing in ourselves, but it was all You. And so, Lord, we give the glory to You and to You alone. Lord, the world needs to know that man in his natural state is estranged from God. Man in his natural state is a sinner, doesn't want God. But Lord, You've commanded us to proclaim to those the gospel. Your sins separate you from God, but Jesus died for your sins on the cross. He was buried, and He bodily rose again on the third day in order to deliver you from sin and all of its consequences. The worst of is eternally separated from God in the torment of hell. So we need to be reminded that death can find you any place. And wherever it finds you, that's where it will keep you. If it finds you not knowing Jesus, you'll spend your eternity separated from God in outer darkness, weeping, wailing, and the gnashing of teeth. And so, Lord, we need to press that gospel message home.
Yes.
Lord, we pray for Sister Lenora, that you will deliver her and touch her and heal her. We pray for Sister Juanita and Sister Caitlin, others who are sick and afflicted. Now, I might not be able to mention all today, but you know who you are. We pray for the family of that young girl that was so mercilessly and brutally taken. I can't imagine it, amen? And so we pray for that family today. We live in an evil and a wicked world and a wicked generation. And as Peter said on the day of Pentecost, save yourselves from this unborn generation. There is no safer place in this world than to be in Jesus, amen? And there is no safer place than to be covered with his arms and his strength. And so out of all that's going on in the world, the place to be, safe in the arms of our Savior, Jesus. Because at the end of the day, the Bible says he conquered all of this. He conquered death, hell, grave, life itself. And he said that in this world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And so we need to grow closer to him and cling more to him. He's the only solution in this world in which we live. No matter where you are in life, no matter what job you do, best place to be, the place to be, is in Jesus Christ. It is by grace through faith that we come to be in Christ our Savior. Father God, praise you and thank you for so much today. We pray in Jesus' blessed name that God's people say amen.
The sister of Laban the Aramean, to be his wife. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord answered him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. But the children struggled together within her. And she said, if it is so, why then am I this way? So she went to inquire of the Lord. The Lord said to her, two nations are in your womb, and two peoples will be separated from your body. And one people shall be stronger than the other, and the other shall serve the younger. When her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. Now the first came forth red, all over like a hairy garment, and they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came forth with his hand holding on to Esau's heel, so his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 60 years old when she gave birth to them. Amen.
Amen.
Let's read in God's word. Let me see it.
Thank you.
Psalm 108, verses 7 through 13. God has spoken in his holiness, I will exalt, I will portion out Shechem, and measure out the valley of Succoth. Gilead is mine, Manasseh is mine, Ephraim also is the helmet of my head. Judah is my scepter, Moab is my washbowl. Over Edom I shall throw my shoe, over Philistia I will shout aloud. Who will bring me into the besieged city? Who will lead me to Edom? Have not you yourself, O God, rejected us? And will you not go forth with our armies, O God? O give us help against the adversary, for deliverance by man is in vain. Through God we will be valiantly, and it is he who shall tread down our adversaries. Amen. Amen. Matthew 19, 7 through 12. Christ gave instructions on divorce. They said to him, why then did Moses command to give her a certificate of divorce and send her away? He said to them, because of your hardness of heart, Moses permitted you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it has not been this way. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for immorality and marries another woman commits adultery. The disciple said to him, if the relationship of the man with his wife is like this, it is better not to marry. But he said to them, not all men can accept this statement, but only those to whom it was given. For there are eunuchs who are born that way from their mother's womb, and there are eunuchs who are made eunuchs by men, and there are also eunuchs who made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. He who is able to accept this, let him accept it. Praise God. Please be seated. Next, we are turning to the Lord.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
Let's continue to worship the Lord. This is Communion Sunday. Let's look at the words as we speak them and sing them. If they are ministering, and at the same time, you're worshiping the Lord. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 14, it says, they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. All the blood of Jesus. Have you been washed in the blood of Jesus?
Oh,
Let us go to our Bibles today and Isaiah 53, just one verse, verse 7. I went further in the study. But once I finished this one particular point, I said to myself, that's enough food for us to chew on for this particular day, because to me, it is quite profound. And so while you go to Isaiah 53 and 7, I'm also going to go to Matthew 16. Verse 16 through 17, or really I'll start at 13, so you can sort of find Isaiah 53, 7, and then put your finger and save the place in Matthew 16, 13 through 17. And I just want to reiterate a little what I said in the call to worship. And that is, we really need to strive to give the Lord our best.
Yes.
And what that means is, at the end of the day, your worship cannot be all about you.
Amen.
Because when it's all about you, it's not worship. And it's not sacrifice. And we need to stop this, I don't feel like it today. I don't feel like going to church. I don't feel like reading. I don't feel like this. Because you don't know when you won't be able to do anything. And I'm going to stress this. If you've done nothing in your Christian life and ministry and all that, and using your gifts and talents in the Lord, and then you get sick and down and out, and you can't do those things, that's what you're going to have to give God. You stand before him. And I don't completely understand this suffering loss and being saved. But it must be serious, otherwise God would not have told us these things in the scripture. So, you know, we need to learn to leave it all on the field. What does that mean? You know, they say with football players, by the end of the game, you shouldn't have anything left over. Give it your all. So what I'm saying is, when you come to the point in your Christian life you can't do for the Lord anymore, you should have left it all out on the field. Well, I had the opportunity. I gave God my best. Amen. And so, you know, a lot of us are weak. First little pain you feel, first thing, but you're going to work. I ain't going to church. So we really need to step it up. Amen?
Amen.
I know how it is. I'm 60. And, you know, you want to slow down. You hear everybody else talking about retirement. And I've been saying, you know, it seems like everybody can retire except the preacher. And I want to slow it down. Now, I do want to delegate some of my responsibilities, but that's so I can step it up in other areas. Amen?
Yeah.
So I hope somebody keep asking how long. I'm going to go at it as hard as I can to when it's time to stop. Amen?
Yeah.
And hopefully I know when that is, because a lot of preachers don't know. Amen? So we need to give God our best.
Yeah.
You know, while we have the opportunity. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to just see a couple things. I had a child at 60. God must have been with him. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I couldn't do it. I said, my Lord, he must have had some supernatural strength of the Lord. I've been hurting myself in my sleep. Amen.
It ain't too late for some of us.
I twist my ankle in my sleep. Amen. So, so I, you know, they just changed. Amen. Then from the second reading, I'm not a union. Amen? I ain't gonna make myself one. I wasn't given a gift, so, you know, all men cannot. I'm one of those guys, all men cannot receive this statement. Amen? Now, let me move on. Isaiah 53:7. Why don't you just read that for me? Read it. Begin.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth.
Now let's go to Matthew 16. I'll start at verse 13. Then you read 17. Now when Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he was asking his disciples, "Who do people say that I, that the Son of Man is?" They said, "Some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah, one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Verse 17, read.
And Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven."
God's people say amen.
Amen.
In many English translations of the scriptures, Matthew 16:13-17, passage we just read, it is entitled Peter's Confession of Christ. Because Peter said to the Lord, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." The word Christ comes from the Greek word Christos, and it means the anointed one. And the context in Matthew 16 is Jesus was and is the anointed one of God. When it comes to the proper mode of biblical interpretation, we must always take into account the grammatical, literary, and the cultural setting in which the words in the Bible were originally written. The technical term for this is the grammatical historical method of interpreting the Bible. So in light of that, we must understand that the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they were all written in the common Greek language of that day. However, there were three primary spoken languages at this time in Palestine or during the New Testament period. They were Jewish Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. This is why when Jesus was crucified to a Roman cross, Pilate had a sign written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek attached to it, and it read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." The text that actually occurs is John 19:17-20, and it says this, "They took Jesus therefore, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of a skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. There they crucified him, with him two other men, one on the other, on either side. And Jesus in between, Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It was written, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Therefore many of the Jews read this inscription. For the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek." The Jews at this time spoke a language which is very, very similar to Hebrew. And it was called Jewish Aramaic. The Romans spoke Latin. And there were also those who spoke Greek. There was a group of Jews called Hellenistic Jews. They were Jews that had been scattered during the reign of Alexander the Great, and they lost their ability to speak Hebrew, and so they spoke the Greek from whence they came. And so there were three main languages being spoken during the New Testament period: Jewish Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. However, they all had one common written language. No matter whether they spoke Aramaic, Latin, or Greek, it was a very common form of Greek called Koine Greek. Because of this, we know that the common language spoken by Jesus and his apostles, they were Jews, was Jewish Aramaic. But they wrote in Greek. That's different from us. We speak in English and we write in English. Well, they spoke in Hebrew or Latin or Greek, but they all wrote in this common Greek language. In view of all of this, Jesus, Peter, and all of the original disciples, they all wrote in this common Greek language, but they spoke in Hebrew and Aramaic. Therefore, when Christ asked the disciples, he actually spoke those words in Jewish Aramaic. Who do people say that I am? But they were written in Greek. Likewise also, when Peter, after hearing Jesus question, confessed in Matthew 16:16, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, he spoke these words in Jewish Aramaic, even though Matthew wrote them down in common, the common Greek of the day. Therefore, when Peter said to Jesus, you are the Christ, what he actually said was, is you are the Messiah. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. After Peter spoke these words, Jesus confirmed Peter's confession that he indeed was Israel's promised Messiah, because he said in 16:17, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In other words, God revealed to Peter that Jesus was the promised Messiah of Israel. These words make it crystal clear that Jesus professed he was the anointed one of God. He was the one that had been promised to the people of God throughout the entire Old Testament scriptures, beginning as far back as Genesis 3:13. In the thinking of the ancient Jewish people, the Messiah, he would be a king who would appear at the end of the age to restore the throne of David. It was believed at the appearing of the Messiah that he would deliver Israel from all of its enemies. And Israel would reign over all with the Messiah in the realm of man, or they would reign with the Messiah over all the earth. They sort of missed the point that the Old Testament also said he was the Savior of the Gentiles. They sort of missed that point. That there would be one people of God, united by faith in one Messiah who would rule. The Messiah was predicted to be one who would be truly God and truly a sinless man. The Messiah was predicted to be one who would do supernatural works only God could do. The Messiah was predicted to be the greatest teacher ever to live among men in relationship to teaching the truth that comes from God. The Messiah was predicted to be a suffering servant of God, who through his suffering would make atonement for the sins of God's people, and through this, make God's people eternally righteous before God. The Messiah was predicted to be one who would die by being pierced through his body. He was predicted to die with common criminals.
He was predicted to be buried in the grave of a rich man. And it was predicted he would be raised from the dead in the glory of God as the exalted servant of God. The Old Testament predicted that the Messiah, he would ascend to the right hand of God and reign over all creation throughout eternity. All of these predictions were contained in the Old Testament scriptures. And so Jesus proved he was this promised Messiah by three basic means. Number one, he fulfilled all the Old Testament scriptures which prophesied or predicted the Messiah's earthly life, his earthly ministry, his death, and his bodily resurrection from the dead. He proved he was the Messiah by performing the supernatural acts of God that only God can do, that violated the laws of nature. And then third, he was bodily raised from the dead on the third day as proof that he was the promised anointed one of God, the Messiah and the Savior of the Gentiles. What concerns us in this series as we explore Isaiah chapter 53 is the fact that Jesus filled all which the Old Testament predicted that the promised Messiah would do. We have been reading of this truth over and over in Luke 24, 25 and 7. After Christ's body resurrection from the dead, he proclaimed to be the Messiah by explaining to those two men on the Emmaus road that should not the Messiah have lived through all of these things? And it says he took them to the scriptures, Moses and all the prophets, and explained to them the things concerning himself as Israel's promised Messiah. He also proclaimed the Messiah. We just read it in Matthew 16, 16. Peter, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Simon, Bar-Jonah, Simon, son of Jonah. Flesh and blood did not reveal that to you, but my Father who is in heaven, he has revealed this to you. Mm-hmm. Isaiah chapter 53. It is one of those Old Testament passages that Jesus would have explained to these men on the Emmaus Road in Luke 24. It would have had to been part of what he explained to show them, should not the Messiah have went through all of these things because the scriptures predicted them, and in showing that I fulfilled these texts as proof that I am the anointed one, I am the Messiah of God. And so this is why we are spending so much time in Isaiah 53, as I've said over and over and over. More than any other text in the Old Testament, it is the largest one uninterrupted narrative that predicted who the Messiah would be and what the Messiah would do. There are many others, but they're scattered all over the Bible, but this one is most concise in revealing that Jesus Christ, he really was the Messiah of God. He really was the anointed one of God. He truly was God. He truly was a sinless man, and he truly did redeem his people from all of their sins.
Amen.
And so this morning, we're going to turn our hearts and minds to Isaiah 53, just one verse, verse 7. And we will see that Jesus fulfilled Isaiah's prediction that the Messiah, he would be a sacrificial lamb. Yeah. Bearing the sin and paying the price or debt for sin in full in behalf of his people. But when he did this, he would be as silent as a lamb. He would never open his mouth. Now, so let's go to Isaiah 53. But let me start at verse 4 and work us to 7. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. that we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities.
Yes.
The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. But the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Verse 7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted. Yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. Now, the primary text I'm dealing with is verse 7. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that is silent before his shearer, so he did not open his mouth. Now, in order to understand verse 7, we've got to go through 4 through 6, because 4 through 6 explains verse 7. In verse 7, it says the Messiah will be oppressed and afflicted. Verse 7. Why? It's answered in verse 4. Our sorrows he carried. He was oppressed and afflicted by what? Because he was carrying the sorrow of our sin. He carried our sorrow. That's what oppressed and afflicted him. These sorrows are the result of sin. It's the result of Adam's sin and our personal sin. And so sorrow is a result of sin. And this oppressed and afflicted the Messiah of Israel. The Messiah would be oppressed and afflicted in verse 7 because he would be stricken and smitten by God. The Messiah would be stricken and smitten by God. Why? Because he was bearing the sins of his people. Verse 4, yet we ourselves esteem him stricken and smitten of God. Now, the reason why we know for certain that the Messiah bearing the griefs of his people, carrying the sorrows of his people, and being smitten and stricken by God was all in relation to the sin of his people, is what we read in verses 5 through 6. And it says this, but he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. All that was fulfilled in Jesus' earthly life. It was fulfilled when he was scourged by Pilate. Texted by his scourging, we are healed. John 19:1. Pilate then took Jesus and what? And scourged him. All of this took place when Jesus' body was pierced by nails in his wrists and ankles when he was nailed to the cross. As recorded in Mark 15:22-24, in fulfillment of Isaiah's word of the Messiah, he would be pierced through for our transgressions. The Bible says, then they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which is translated place of a skull. They tried to give him wine based on myrrh, but he did not take it. And then it says, and they crucified him. They pierced his body with the nails in the hands and the feet. All of this was done in our behalf. Paul speaks of this in Romans 4:23-25. Now not for his or Abraham's sake only was it written that it was credited to him, but for our sake also, to whom it was credited, as those who believe in him who raised our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. He was delivered because of our transgression.
Amen.
And was raised for what? Our justification. Jesus delivered us of our transgressions through his suffering and his death on the cross. Paul spoke of this same truth in 2 Corinthians 5:20-21. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him, Jesus, to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus was made to be sin for us through his suffering and the cross of his crucifixion. We see the same thing in Ephesians 2, 13 through 16. But now in Christ Jesus, you who formerly were far off have been brought near by what? The blood of Christ.
Amen.
For he himself is our peace, who made both groups, Jew and Gentile, or not Jew and non-Jewish, into one, and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in his flesh the enmity, which is the law contained in ordinances, so that he himself might make the two into one new man, thus establishing peace, notice, and might reconcile them both as one body to God,
yes,
through the cross.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes. Now all of this speaks of the substitutionary suffering and death of Christ on the cross. It was a substitutionary sacrifice made unto God in our behalf, paid the debt of our sin. He substituted himself in our place. He took our sin in his body. Our God cast all of our sin on him, and he took our place, and on the cross, he experienced the hell and torment you and I deserve.
Amen. Amen.
By virtue of the fact that we are sinners estranged from God.
Yes.
Now, next Sunday, I'm going to go more in depth about the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ on the cross for us. But for this morning, I want to consider verse 7. In the context of the Messiah was predicted by Isaiah as one who would be oppressed and afflicted on account of the sins of his people. He would be oppressed and afflicted. Why? Because he would be bearing the griefs of his people. He was oppressed and afflicted because he was carrying the sorrows of his people.
Yes, yes.
He was predicted as one who would be smitten and stricken by God. Why? For the sins of his people. He was predicted as one who would be pierced through his body for the transgressions of his people. He would be crushed for the sins of his people.
Yes.
His body would be scourged for his people. He was oppressed and afflicted because the Lord called the iniquities of us to fall on him. Yet, in spite of all that, he did not open his mouth.
Yes.
Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter. Like a sheep that is silent before its shearers. So he did not open his mouth. What does Isaiah mean by those words? What it means is this. The Messiah would never object or try to avoid the suffering he would receive for the transgressions of his people. What Isaiah meant through these words was the Messiah would never utter words that it's not right for me to go to the cross. He would never say, it's not right for you to afflict me. He would never say, it's not right that you scourge me. I'm sinless. I'm the Son of God. He would never open his mouth when he's being pierced in his body. Go back and read it. As they nailed him, it said nothing. He didn't say a word. As they drove the nails through, he didn't say, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't. No, he was as silent as a lamb when they drove the nails. When we read about him during being scourged, the Bible doesn't say he hollered out, y'all do this to me. He never said a word. When they raised him on the cross, he never said, y'all need to take me down. It's not right. I'm perfect. I'm the Holy One of God. I've never committed one sin in my life. Not right that I'm up here. Y'all take me down. He never said a word. He was as silent as a lamb being led to the slaughter, and he never opened his mouth.
Well,
you study the account of the Gospels, you will see Jesus fulfill this to the letter. Never uttered a word as far as trying to get away from the cross. He never said, I'm an innocent man. This is not right. He remained silent. So let's do some reading today. I'm trying to make this in order.
Yes.
Matthew 26, 57 through 66.
Christ, the Son of the Blessed One. And he said, I am.
And you shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven. Jesus, tearing his cloak, the high priest said, what further need do we have witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. How does it seem to you? And they all condemned him to be deserving of death. But you notice he never said, it's not right for you to put me to death. And they asked him, who are you? Are you the Son of God? You're right about that one. But notice they kept saying he deserved death. Notice he never said, that's not true. I don't deserve no death. Luke 22. 66. Luke 22, 66. I know this is a lot of reading, but see, this is a television, amen. Whatever y'all be watching, this is better, amen. Luke 22, 66. When it was day, the council of the elders of the people assembled, both chief priests and scribes, and they led him away to their council chamber, saying, if you are the Christ, tell us. But he said to them, if I tell you, you will not believe. But if I ask a question, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. And they all said, are you the Son of God then? And he said to them, yes, I am. Testimony. But we have heard it from ourselves, from his own mouth. Then the whole body of them got up and brought him before Pilate, and they began to accuse him, saying, we found this man misleading our nation and forbidding to pay taxes to Caesar, saying that he himself is Christ, king. So Pilate asked him, are you the king of the Jews? And he answered and said, it is as you say. Then Pilate said to the chief priests and crowds, find no fault in this man. But they kept insisting, saying, he stirs up the people, teaching all over Judea, starting from Galilee, even as far as this place. When Pilate heard it, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he belonged to Herod's district, he sent him to Herod, who himself was also in Jerusalem at the time. Now Herod was very glad when he saw Jesus, for he wanted to see him for a long time, because he had been hearing about him and was hoping to see some sign performed by him. Sound like folks? Let me move on. Amen. Sound like folks flocking out to see somebody work a miracle. Amen. And it's a fraud. But let me move on today. And he questioned him at some length. But what happened? He answered him nothing. And the chief priests and scribes were standing there accusing him vehemently. And Herod with the soldiers after treating him with contempt and mocking him, dressed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him back to Pilate. Now Herod and Pilate became friends with each other that very day, for they had been enemies with each other. For before they had been enemies with each other. Pilate summoned the chief priests and the rulers of the people and said to them, we brought this man to be as one who incites the people to rebellion. And behold, having examined him, before you, I find no guilt in this man regarding the charge that you make against him. No, nor has Herod. For he sent him back to us. And behold, nothing deserving of death has been done by him. Therefore, I will punish him and release him. One more, and then we'll be finished. John 18, 19. John 18, 19-24. John 18, 19-24. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered him, I've spoken openly to the world. I always taught in the synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews were come together, and I spoke nothing in secret. Why do you question me? Question those who have heard what I spoke to them. They know what I said. When he had said this, one of the officers standing struck Jesus, saying, is that the way you answer the high priest? Jesus answered, I've spoken wrong. He testified the wrong, but if rightly, why do you strike me? So Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. But you notice he's never saying, I want out of this. Mm-hmm. Now when they ask him, who are you? He tells them. That's right. He never denied that. But he's not trying to weasel out of this. 18:28-38. Then they led Jesus from Caiaphas into the praetorium. And it was early, and they themselves did not enter to the praetorium, so that they would not be defiled, but might eat Passover. Therefore, Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered and said to him, "This man were not an evildoer, we would not have delivered him to you." So Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews said to him, "We are not permitted to put anybody to death." To fulfill the word of Jesus which he had spoke, signifying by what kind of death he was about to die. Therefore Pilate entered again into the return and summoned Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Are you saying this on your own initiative, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate answered, "I'm not a Jew. Am I your own nation, and the chief priest delivered you to me? What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servant would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not of this realm." Therefore Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say correctly that I am a king. For this I have been born, and for this I have come into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" When he had said this, he went out again to the Jews and said to them, "I find no guilt in him." Notice, three times Pilate said, "This man is innocent. This man is innocent. This man is innocent. I find no guilt in him." That was true. But Jesus never used that to try to get away from the cross. When they nailed him, he didn't say a word. All the text says is, "And then they crucified him." Now, historians tell us most of the time when they crucified guys back then, they were screaming. You would be, amen. Wouldn't you? Nailing you, you'd be screaming. "Get me down, I'm innocent, I didn't do none of this." Normally, the historians said they would be screaming, cursing, foul, filthy. Horrible. It was a horrible death. But he did not utter a word. And Pilate makes it clear, this man is innocent. And as Isaiah 53:7 says, "Yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, like a sheep that is silent before shearers, so he did not open his mouth." Two things I want us to consider, then I'm through. Number one, Jesus remaining silent. By him remaining silent, he fulfills Isaiah 53:7, as predicted that the Messiah, he would keep his mouth closed while it was being nailed, while it was being scourged, while it was being afflicted, while it was being smitten. Nobody else in history fits this. Amen. Except Jesus.
Amen.
Nobody else fits this. Except Jesus. So this is proof that he had to be the one. Nobody else. Then number two. It involves a question I believe all of God's people need to ponder. The question is this, listen. Other than fulfilling the scriptures, that the Messiah will be as silent as a lamb, being led to the slaughter. But what are the reasons why Jesus never uttered a word? So in other words, number one, he fulfilled scripture and remained silent. But for what else did he remain silent? Never uttering a word. He went through his affliction, never uttered a word, never said, "Don't nail me." And Pilate scourged him, he never said, "No, don't scourge me." Never said any of that. The question is all the more thought-provoking as we acknowledge the fact that Jesus really did not belong on the cross because of who he was. That is, he was truly God and truly sinless man. It can never be said that God deserves pain and affliction. And it is unjust to penalize a sinless man. If a man is sinless, there's nothing to nail him to a cross for. So, he really did. didn't belong there when we consider who he was and what he did. And that is, he was sinless. He never committed one sin. He was very God, a very God and sinless man. One person with two natures, the nature of God and the nature of a sinless man. So when we consider who he was, he really didn't belong on the cross. He really didn't deserve to be scourged. He really didn't deserve to be nailed. He really didn't deserve to be spit on. He really didn't deserve the crowns pressed in his scalp.
Amen. Teach, Pastor. Teach.
He didn't deserve it. So the question is, why did he not ever object to what they did to him? I'm going to answer the question.
Amen.
Truth of the matter is, in order for us to be redeemed and delivered once and for all from sin and all its consequences, Jesus could not plead innocent. He could never say, I don't deserve this. Why? Because we're not innocent.
Amen.
And we deserve the hell and torment. Let me say it again. The reason why he never tried to get out of it, the reason why he pled guilty, is because we're guilty.
Yeah. Amen.
We're not innocent.
Amen.
Now, let me see if I can explain this to you. Remember, Peter was not suffering and dying for himself. He was suffering and dying in our place. Put it simply, Jesus was paying the penal price for our sin. In order to do that, Jesus could never say he did not deserve the suffering on the cross for our guilt and suffer for our sin in place of him. See, we were guilty of sin. And all of its results.
Oh, yes.
Therefore, Jesus had to accept the guilty plea in our behalf for us to be saved. Are you understanding?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
The reason why he never said that's not right, put me there, is because it was right for us to be there.
Yes.
And he was substituting himself in our behalf.
Yes.
He didn't deserve it, but you did, yes. And I did. Yes. Therefore, he never tried to get out of it.
Yes.
Or died for you. He pled guilty in your behalf. For your sin, he suffered himself for your sin.
Yes.
That's why he never said a word. He was innocent, but we are guilty of everything God has charged against us.
Yes.
Jesus.
Forgiveness is based on confession of a wrong done. We know Christ as Savior. We know Christ as Savior. We are redeemed because Jesus pleaded guilty in our behalf, according to our sin and our iniquity being laid on him. Then all of the torment and pain Jesus endured unto death was the eternal torment we deserved in hell for our sin.
Woo!
Are you with me today?
Amen. Oh, amen.
The reason he didn't say anything because you're guilty.
Amen.
Amen.
He was accepting guilt in your behalf.
Yes.
Therefore, you couldn't say, it's not right. Because it was right for you.
Yes.
And he pled guilty in your behalf.
Yes.
According to your sins laying on him, even though he was sinless.
Yes.
Even though he didn't deserve it. I want to be clear that Jesus was not a sinner.
Amen.
He didn't turn into a demon on the cross as Word of Faith heresy teaches. He didn't go to the torment of hell and then God called Satan on the technicality and had to let him go.
Well.
But he did take our sin upon himself. And pleaded guilty for our sins in our behalf. In order that when those of us who know Christ as Savior would be innocent, in order that those of us who know Christ as Savior would be innocent before God
of all of our sins.
Yes.
I'm gonna wrap it up. As a matter of fact, because Jesus pleaded guilty in our behalf, as evidenced by the fact he didn't once try to get out of the cross. Listen, because he pleaded guilty in our behalf, we can never be guilty before God.
Amen. Amen.
For our sin.
Amen.
Because he pled guilty in our behalf.
Yes.
For our sins. We cannot be declared by God to be guilty of sin. God cannot declare those in Christ guilty because Jesus accepted our guilt. God cannot charge those in Christ to be guilty because Jesus has pleaded guilty in our behalf and then paid the debt of being guilty with this cruel, agonizing death on the cross. That's why he never tried to get out of it. God cannot now declare me guilty because I'm in Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
And my guilt has already been eternally dealt with through Jesus on the cross. Let me see if I can explain it like this, and I'm going to sit down. In the 1980s and 1990s, approximately 49 women were murdered in the state of Washington near the Green River. In 2003, Gary Ridgway pleaded guilty to 48 of those murders. He received life in prison for all 48 that he pled guilty to, and he got another 480 years for tampering with evidence. He is currently in prison with no chance of ever getting out. Listen, because Gary Ridgway pleaded guilty to these 48 murder counts, neither you or I can ever be declared guilty for these murders, because someone has already pled guilty for them. No one could justly charge me with one of these murders because someone has already pled guilty. And he's paying the price. In a similar way, Jesus pleaded guilty in our behalf.
Yes.
For all of our sins.
Yes.
And not only did he say guilty for us, then he paid the price.
Yes.
With his life.
Yes.
On the cross.
Yes.
Because Jesus pleaded guilty for us in our sin, we can never be charged with sin and declare guilty. If Jesus would have uttered to his accuser that he didn't deserve death and suffer because he was holy and perfect, none of us could be saved because he pleaded guilty on our behalf by remaining silent and accepting the punishment on the cross for our guilt and our sin. Apart from this, no one could ever be saved.
Thank you.
If you pled guilty to God, what price are you going to pay to get off the hook?
Nothing.
What do you mean? You're messed up. I'm messed up. If we said, God, I'm guilty of my sin, what will we give God to pay the price to make good on what we've done to God? You can't give him your life because it's full of sin. You can't give him your thought life. That's loaded with a lot of sin. You can't give him what you say because every now and then a curse word slips out. You can't give him your feet because every now and then they take you to the wrong place. You couldn't give him your hands because every now and then they get a hold of the wrong thing. You couldn't give them your eyes because they gazing at that which is not right all the time.
Uh-huh.
If you pled guilty to God, what did you give him to escape the judgment?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Jesus.
But the sinless God man could.
Yes. Amen.
Father, I take their sins on me. I plead guilty in their behalf. And yes. Father, I offer to you as a payment myself. I'm holy. I'm perfect. I'm just as perfect as you, Father. You and I are one. Everything you can do, I can do. As a father is life in himself,
in my behalf. All the sins of David Kinlow were laid on him, and in my place he said, guilty as charged. Yes. I'm not going to try to get away from it. I will be nailed to the cross in his behalf. Put your name in there if you know this God made Jesus.
Yes.
Debt's been paid.
Yes. Yes.
Praise God. Praise
it's done.
Yes.
That's why Jesus cried out, it is finished.
Yes.
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 And that's why that fifth soil, it should all go to the glory of God.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
It's not you, it's not me, we're nothing.
Yes.
We are sinners.
Yes.
On our best day, we still fall short of the glory of God.
Yes.
And we fall short of the glory of God every day on our
yes.
best day.
Yes.
We still fall short.
Yes.
Messiah and Savior. Amen.
Yes.
He was willing to take that upon himself.
Yes.
Yes.
And pay the price for my sin. In full. Once and for all.
Yes.
In order that I might possess the righteousness of Christ. His righteousness.
Yes.
And therefore when God sees me, all he sees is the righteousness of Jesus Christ. On you and I.
Yes.
You know, I probably need to do more with that, but that's as far as I can take it today. And I don't know if I've explained it well enough, but I've tried and I've left it all on the field. Amen.
Yes.
Whenever I can get right with God, I'll get right the next time. I'm so glad he paid the price.
Yes.
I'm so glad he didn't come to that cross and say, you know what? These people ain't worth nothing. I'm just glad he
did.
Yes. Today you do not know Jesus Christ. died for you. Your iniquities were laid on him. He accepted the penalty. Paid with his life. He paid with his blood. He paid by suffering the agony you deserve in hell. And we can receive him and be redeemed, pass from death unto life. Repentance of sin. Lord, I'm sorry for my sin. And faith in Jesus Christ that he died for you. He was buried. And he bodily rose again on the third day. If there's one and you want one of these altar workers to pray with you, would you just raise your hand? Perhaps there's somebody you already saved. You prayed about it, you thought about it, and you believe God wants you to be a member of this church. These altar workers can help you also if there is one that you raise your hand. Father God, I praise you and thank you for all things. Lord, help me to rightly divide the word of truth. These are deep issues. So we want to get it right. Where we fall short, Lord, show us. And then let us be humble enough when we get it wrong to say we got it wrong, but this is what the truth of God is. Lord, I pray for Sister Lenora. She's in a bad way, and you know, Lord. Lord, deliver her. Lord, heal her. Pray for Sister Bonita, cancer. Sister Kate under surgical procedure. We pray for my Aunt Peachy recuperating from some physical problems she's in Carolinas. Pray for Brother Tim, Sister Tina. And Lord, I pray for all of us with our even minor ailments. Lord, keep us going. Because we want to do more for you. Amen?
Amen.
We want to press on to the higher call of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So Lord, give us exactly what we need. I was talking to Minister Cole this morning. I said, man, Pastor Smith's leg hurting, your foot hurting, and my ankle hurting. We in bad shape. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, keep us. Lord, strengthen us.
Yes.
I'm not ready to sit down in the car. I want to preach some more. I want to proclaim the gospel some more. And Lord, I want to do it with all my heart. Lord, strengthen us. Strengthen all of us. Lord, bring the people into this church that we need. We're getting older.
Yes.
Whether you know it or not, young folks, the time is being passed slowly. It's being passed. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So this church is to go on and needs you. So Lord, I pray that you will raise those up in order that this good work of getting out the gospel, it will continue. Father God, I praise you and thank you for each and everything today. We pray in Jesus' name that God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you for these gifts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.